Blog Talk Radio.
Paranormal Review Radio. Hello and welcome, everyone. It is Friday night, and you're listening to Paranormal Review Radio, the only radio show without commercials and with more great paranormal talk. Thank you all for joining us tonight. I am Anthony Agati in New York.
And I'm Lucy Liebfried in Chicago. Are you ready for another Paranormal Friday night? Thank you all for joining us tonight. We welcome all of our regular listeners and those of you who have tuned in for the very first time. If you have a question for our guest or about the topic tonight, feel free to ask us in the chat room or call into the show at 661-244-9831. Please press 1 to speak to the host. Now, don't forget, you can always send us an email with future topics that you'd like to see on the show, or maybe you have a story or a theory that you want to share with us on air. Our email address is paranormalreviewradio@yahoo.com. We also have our own YouTube channel where you can listen in to all of our previous shows. Now, don't forget to check us out on our Facebook show page for more info on the paranormal and upcoming shows.
You know, there are many mysterious places in America that defy simple, everyday explanations, like Mel's Hole and Safa Sanctuary in Washington, the Oregon Vortex in Gold Hill, Oregon, Skinwalker Ranch in Utah, and even the Big Lick Triangle in Indiana. But have you ever heard about the Bridgewater Triangle in Massachusetts? If you have, I'm sure you will learn something new tonight. And if you haven't, then buckle your seatbelts, because it's going to be a ride of a lifetime. The Bridgewater Triangle has got to be one of the more fascinating paranormal locations in America, and dare I say, in the world. The new documentary, simply titled The Bridgewater Triangle, was a movie decades in the making, as no one has done before. Directors Aaron Cadieux and Manny Famolare teamed up in 2011 to begin production on this amazing film, each bringing their expertise, passion, and commitment in creating this piece of work with a very neutral and journalistic approach, verifying all evidence and statements made by witnesses and historic accounts. Aaron is a born filmmaker and grew up in the town of North Dartmouth, and Manny Famolare is a lover of the camera and, as a lifelong resident in East Bridgewater, has investigated the Triangle's phenomenon for over 25 years. Together, this dynamic duo feverishly worked for 3 years through filming, scriptwriting, and researching the Bridgewater Triangle, all so that you, the viewers, can easily understand the phenomenon and be able to make sense, but yet be amazed by all the evidence and eyewitness accounts. Tonight, Lucy and I hope to do the film justice by letting you all out there listening to get into the minds of the creators of this brilliant and mesmerizing documentary, The Bridgewater Triangle. But like with anything else, tonight's interview won't give you the full experience. You must watch the film. So everyone, take down this website name, thebridgewatertriangledocumentary.com, and download the movie this weekend. I guarantee you, you won't be disappointed. Please help me in welcoming to the show the co-director of the documentary, The Bridgewater Triangle, Aaron Cadieux. Hey, Aaron. Thanks for coming on the show tonight.
Well, thank you very much for having me. It's an honor to be here, and thank you very much for that very, very generous introduction you read about us.
Well, you know, just before coming on the air, we learned that originally we were supposed to have Manny Famolare on as well, and we learned that he had to cancel last minute. So we are happy to have you, Aaron, on the show, and I guarantee you it will still be an amazing, amazing time for us. So thank you for coming on.
Oh, thank you for having me. Yeah, I'm sure we'll fill the time very well.
Hi, Aaron. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
You know what, Aaron, I learned that you actually created a 30-minute film on Bridgewater back in 2003 while you were in college, And you started to see a cult-like following to it. So what is it about this location in Massachusetts? Do you think it's the quantity of stories that are recorded, or is it more the quality of these stories that draw people into its phenomena?
I think you got a little bit of both there. I think it's both the quality and the quantity, and the fact that, you know, I'm very largely a skeptic when it comes to most of the stories that I hear. And I tell people when I went into this production, I was a 99% skeptic, and I walked away still being probably a 96% skeptic. So from my perspective, sometimes I wonder if it's more or less like the chicken or the egg, because, you know, this region was defined back in the late 70s by Lauren Coleman, who was documenting a lot of strange occurrences out of especially the Hockomock Swamp region in the Bridgewater Triangle. And because people were alerted to the fact that there may be strange occurrences going on, does that make them more aware that they're living in a region that's known for a higher level of these occurrences? Does that make them be on the lookout for these things more than the average person? And being on the lookout for them, does that make them more likely to see something or see something and then automatically chalk it up to being paranormal? That's the question that I ask, and unfortunately, it's a question that I still can't answer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, you know what? You and Manny had not known each other before 2011. So what was the connection that you both had to co-create this documentary and trust each other enough to make a film together?
Well, I mean, I had done, like you had mentioned, I had done a short 30-minute documentary in the Bridgewater Triangle back in college, and because there was such an interest, I always had it in the back of my mind that if I'm ever, you know, running my own business and have more experience and more established, I'd like to reapproach this topic and do a feature-length film. And in 2010, I felt, you know, maybe the time's right to start laying the foundation to do this. And I was always looking around on the internet to see if anybody else was working on the same thing or if somebody else had already almost finished a documentary. I didn't want to be, you know, the second guy to make the documentary. I wanted to be the first. And I found some information that Manny Famolare was putting some feelers out to do his own documentary on the Bridgewater Triangle. And we got in touch with each other, talked on the phone, met in person, and we felt comfortable enough with each other and each other's vision for what they wanted the film to be that we decided to join forces.
You know, one of the things that we always do, Lucy and I do for the show and for our investigations that we do, is tons of research. And I know that you did tons of research for this documentary. But how extensive was the research? I mean, did you have to go the unconventional route at times, or was it just the digging and more digging?
Well, that was one of the great things about working with Manny because, I mean, I grew up in North Dartmouth, which is a town just south of the Bridgewater Triangle, and up until 2003, I had never heard of it. And I had grown up 6 miles down the street from the Freetown State Forest and knew all of the stories and that came out of that area, but I did not know that the Freetown State Forest was tied into this larger concept of this 200-square-mile Bridgewater Triangle. So Manny, though, grew up in East Bridgewater, and he did know about the existence of this Bridgewater Triangle, and so he had been researching the Bridgewater Triangle for years before I had even started researching it in 2003. So he had archives of newspaper articles that he had pulled out while going into the microfilm rooms in different libraries and just combing the newspapers for all these stories of strange occurrences. So Manny had done a lot of the research, you know, and then we also featured a lot of those same people that were in the original documentary that I did while at Fitchburg State, and then we both kind of just pounded the pavement looking for people that might have strange stories. You know, we featured a lot of experts in the field, in the film, a lot of paranormal researchers and authors who had done a lot of research on the Bridgewater Triangle, and they were nice enough a lot of times to point us in the direction of people that might be willing to tell their stories. So it was kind of a combination of pre-existing stories that we knew about, reaching out to people that we were directed to from the experts, and going back to some of those newspaper articles and even pulling the names out of those, Googling where these people live and trying to get in touch with them that way.
Hmm. Well, how did you first learn about the Bridgewater Triangle?
I was researching various haunted locations in Massachusetts as a possible documentary topic because, you know, Halloween's my favorite holiday, and you know, I've always been drawn to things that are, you know, dark or morbid or, you know, spooky. and I was researching Spider Gate Cemetery up in Worcester, Massachusetts, which is a pretty well-known haunted location, or allegedly haunted location, I should say.
Right.
And I just happened to stumble across Christopher Pittman's website, cellarwalls.com, and Christopher was actually featured extensively in our film. And he had a whole article that he had written about the Bridgewater Triangle on his website, and that's how I found out about it. And I said, oh, I know the Freetown State Forest. I live right down the road from there. And the rest was history. I mean, then I was just hooked. It was a topic that was local. It was accessible. It had a lot of different elements to it. And, you know, it seemed like an appropriate subject.
And you had not been interested in the paranormal before that. You were just sort of looking for something intriguing enough for possible viewers for this documentary.
Exactly. You know, I still to this day, I don't really consider myself a paranormal researcher or a paranormal investigator or anything like that. I'm a filmmaker and a storyteller, and I felt that the whole concept of the Bridgewater Triangle, whether you believe in it or not, is interesting. Even if you're coming at it from the perspective of somebody who doesn't necessarily believe the stories, just the social phenomenon and trying to put your finger on what's driving it is interesting enough in enough by itself.
Were you surprised at sort of the reaction, even from your first short film in college, of the reaction of people?
Yeah, I was. I was a bit surprised. I you know, gave a copy to a friend more or less as just a, hey, check out this film that I made. And then he gave it to a friend who gave it to a friend. And then I was getting phone calls and emails of people asking, where can I buy the film? And that original film, I couldn't sell it. You know, I was a college student. I didn't know a lot about copyright law, so I used music and images I didn't have permission for and things like that. So I couldn't sell it. But once
right.
I saw that there was an appetite for that kind of a thing, I decided, you know, I'd like to redo this someday. And I mean, if you just look in the media around you, I mean, every major cable outlet has a ghost hunting show or a Bigfoot hunting show or UFO shows. It's just it's a big topic in today's society, and doesn't seem to be showing any signs of slowing down.
Yeah, even I think the Food Network even has something to do with paranormal in it.
Yeah, it's amazing. Every one of those networks.
It is. So let's talk about the Bridgewater Triangle. I mean, we may have some viewers who are not familiar with this story. What are some of the claims and phenomenon, and how is the triangle location mapped out?
We'll start with the boundaries of the triangle. It's a 200-square-mile region in southeastern Massachusetts. So if you're looking at a map of Massachusetts, this is just before you start to get down towards Cape Cod. The northern point of the triangle is a town called Abington. The southeastern corner of the triangle is a town called Freetown, and the southwestern corner of the triangle is a town called Rehoboth. Now, towns are not dots on the map. Towns have different shapes and sizes, so the boundaries of the triangle can vary slightly depending on how you draw the lines. And the region was first defined by Lauren Coleman back in the late 70s. He's probably the world's foremost cryptozoologist, and he had moved from California to Massachusetts, and he started getting a lot of reports of strange occurrences, particularly in an area called the Hockomock Swamp, which is seen as the epicenter of the Bridgewater Triangle.
Right.
A lot of reports of a cryptozoological nature. And so that's kind of where the triangle got its origins, and that was in the late 70s. And, you know, he started to gather reports of other strange occurrences that started to stretch outside of the Hockomock Swamp region, and that's where he came up with the boundaries of this triangle.
And what are some of the claims, or what are some of the accounts that people are claiming?
Yeah, I kind of think of it as a buffet of the unexplained, not even necessarily just the paranormal. I mean, you have a lot of other things at play here, but you have everything from cryptozoological sightings involving, you know, Bigfoot-like creatures, giant winged creatures described as thunderbirds, one-of-a-kind stories like a gentleman in the film who claimed he saw a 3-foot-tall hair-covered creature while walking his dog near the Hockomock Swamp. You have ghosts spiritual sightings in places like Rehoboth and East Bridgewater. And you have a lot of Native American legends and folklore mixed in, including a mythical creature in Native American legend called a Puckwudgie, which we describe and talk about in the film. And then in the Freetown State Forest, which is kind of in the lower right-hand portion of the triangle, you have a very high level of crime in that region, and it's kind of off the charts for a little town of 9,000 people. That's seen its fair share of bizarre crimes and bizarre occurrences that aren't necessarily paranormal in nature, but a lot of researchers kind of tie it into the Bridgewater Triangle and claim that there's some sort of a negative energy that's drawing people in to do those things in the Freetown State Forest.
Mm. Yeah, that
and
really
UFO sightings.
Me.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, on top of that. Well, you know what Anthony mentioned in the intro of the records of other locations that may have similar occurrences like the Skinwalker Ranch and the Oregon Vortex. Had any research been done on other locations to see if there were any similarities in the nature of the stories and experiences?
I hadn't actually started researching other locations till even after we were finished with our film. The only other triangle that I kind of knew a little bit about was the Bennington Triangle in Vermont, which is, it's kind of I don't think it's quite as well known as the Bridgewater Triangle. And if you actually Google to try to find a map of the Bennington Triangle, you actually can't find one. They haven't really drawn the lines, you know, as extensively as they have with the Bridgewater Triangle. But that's another location known for, you know, unexplained disappearances, cryptic animal sightings, and things of that nature. But outside of the Bennington Triangle, I hadn't heard of any of these other locations because, like I said, I'm not really a paranormal enthusiast. But, you know, the Skinwalker Ranch has been mentioned tons of times since we released this film.
So why do you think this triangle exists? I mean, is it more than just a melting pot of paranormal things, or is it something bigger than we can understand?
You know, as a skeptic, I don't really know, and that's a tough thing for me to answer. There seems to be the fingerprints of Native American folklore and history intertwined extensively with the Bridgewater Triangle region. You have a lot of locations within the triangle that have a Native American connection, and the region was the site of an armed conflict that took place between 1675 and 1676, which actually, on a per capita basis, was the bloodiest war in American history, and it was called King Philip's War, and it was basically the uprising of the Wampanoag tribe against the colonial settlers in the region at that time. So, you know, you're talking about a conflict where 5% of the combined population of New England was completely wiped out. And a lot of the major fighting took place in southeastern Massachusetts in the Bridgewater Triangle region, but the conflict then, you know, spread out even out to western Massachusetts and other parts of New England. But the origins of King Philip's War can be traced directly to, you know, the Bridgewater Triangle region. And a lot of researchers claim that that conflict left a negative stain on the region, and it was kind of the spark for the negative energy that seems to be emerging from there.
Now, you've mentioned that you're not a paranormal enthusiast. You're more journalistic in nature, and that was the purpose of putting, and that was the reasoning behind and the efforts behind putting forward this great documentary. But you did mention just earlier that you were sort of 99%, and now you're sort of 96%.
Yeah.
Was there anything that sort of, you know, brought that number down to 96%? Was there any
happened? Yeah, I would say there was three instances. Well, two stories in the film and one occurrence in the film that really, even as a skeptic, made me take a step back and kind of scratch my head and say, wow, maybe there really is something larger going on here. The first was, I mentioned earlier, a gentleman named Bill Russo was walking his dog in Raynham, which is a town near the Hockomock Swamp region, and he claims to have came across this 3-foot-tall, hair-covered creature that kind of emerged from the woods and walked underneath a street lamp. And he claims that this creature attempted to communicate with him verbally and beckoned him to come closer. And when we interviewed him for his story, at least from my perspective, he just comes across as such a genuine, you know, kind person that it would be it's almost impossible to imagine him making this up. Not to mention the fact that he didn't come out with his story until over 20 years after the experience happened because he was so fearful of ridicule. He didn't want to lose his job. He didn't want to be labeled as a crazy person. And his story, it just made the hair on the back of my neck stand up when he retold it. And it's actually, you know, one of the more popular segments in the film, and it's one of my favorites.
Yeah, when I watched the film, his story really intrigued me. And not only just because of the contents of what he was talking about and his experience, but he was so believable. He seemed to be a true witness to it.
Absolutely, yes. It's just, and I don't know what it is. He's just, the best way I can describe Bill Russo is he seems like he could be anybody's grandfather.
Right, right.
He just has a very endearing quality to him that just makes it seem that much more credible that he saw what he says he saw. And, you know, we went out to the location with him. He took us around the neighborhood where he used to walk his dog and where he used to live. And it was quite an experience to be there where he claims that he saw this creature. And he's actually gone on to be featured on Destination America's Monsters and Mysteries in America. They picked up on his story after he had appeared in our film. And so his story is getting some legs and getting some more notoriety. And it's justly so. I mean, it's a really, really intriguing story.
So was there another incident or story that changed it?
There was a UFO sighting which occurred in the spring of 1979 that involved two WHDH news reporters who were traveling to a location called the Raynham Dog Track, which is in the heart of the Hockomock Swamp. They were traveling there after work. They pulled off of the exit on the highway, and they both claimed to have seen this enormous home plate shaped object flying very slow in the sky and very low in the sky just over the exit. And they actually pulled the vehicle over to the side of the road to watch this. They claimed that the craft had a huge light on the front of it, and it was, like I said, moving extremely slowly, and then all of a sudden it just took off. And here you have two well-known people in the community, basically local celebrities, who had a lot to lose by coming out with a story like this if they didn't seem credible. But they both corroborated the exact same story. And the thing that makes that sighting so interesting is that in that spring of 1979, there were a series of sightings in southeastern Massachusetts of that exact same craft, not exactly at the same time, but in the months of that year, in the spring months of that year, there were a few people that saw that craft. And the Brockton Enterprise, which is a newspaper down in this area, wrote an article about all these sightings that were occurring of this craft, and they came up with their sketch artist came up with a drawing which incidentally looked exactly like what these two reporters claimed that they saw. So that story was really interesting. Now whether what they saw was something of an extraterrestrial origins, we don't, you know, I can't say, but they definitely did see something out of the ordinary. It wasn't a plane from what I've come to understand.
Right. And you know, the two stories that you just talked about with Bill Russo and this UFO story, you go into more depth in it in the documentary, and I'm telling you, it's really fascinating. And one of the things that really, I think also too with Bill Russo's story that got me was that communication between that creature that he was talking about, which I'm not going to get into. I want everybody to listen to it because it was really, truly amazing and almost gave me chills on the back of, you know, on my spine. It's a really great clip from there. But, you know,
well,
go ahead. I'm sorry.
No. Continue. I was just going to say that. Yeah. That just editing that scene together when we're putting the film together. I mean, we play it back and watch it, and it just really just sent a chill down the spine. But continue. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, that's okay. I mean, you're just talking about editing, and you know, I work in the entertainment industry during my day job, and I know. I know in any type of production there are things that, you know, don't or won't make the final edit for whatever reason. Were there things that you uncovered during your research of the experiences or the history that may have been too controversial or not had enough evidence to substantiate to put in the film?
More so, yeah, that there wasn't enough evidence. Now, if you watch the film, we try to get as many firsthand eyewitness accounts that we can. You know, there is some secondhand testimony of people who knew a person who saw something, but we tried to stay away from that for the most part. And there are a lot of those type stories out there. Like my cousin saw a Bigfoot back in 1983 while driving down such and such a street in such a town. But you know, a lot of them are dead ends, and you know, you'll try to find the person who that person is claiming saw whatever they saw, but you can't track them down. Or they don't live around here anymore. They don't, you know, the person lost their phone number or lost their contact information. So there is a lot of that.
Right.
And we tried to stay away from it the best that we could. The other thing, too, is we do cover, you know, reports of hauntings in the film, particularly in Rehoboth and East Bridgewater, which are the two towns in the Bridgewater Triangle, which seem to have the highest level of reports of hauntings. But if you were to do a documentary about every haunted house in the Bridgewater Triangle, never mind every haunted, allegedly haunted house in the United States, you'd be talking about, you know, like a 60-hour series. It would be impossible to cover all of it. So we had to draw the line somewhere. And we featured some EVP recordings from an investigation of an allegedly haunted home in East Bridgewater. And the reason that we featured that was because the EVP that was recorded at that location was so compelling and so different from any other EVPs that I've ever heard. And I'm very much a skeptic when it comes to EVPs. But I won't get into all the reasons for that. But that one in particular kind of was more interesting than a lot of the EVPs I've heard on some of these nationally broadcasted ghost hunting shows. It was that loud gunshot that, you know, everybody claims that they didn't hear at the time but only heard in the recording later. So those are the kind of things that, you know, we had to limit, you know, secondhand stories, you know, ghost stories from different houses in the region. And there were also some other stories that were difficult to, there's a location within the Bridgewater Triangle called the Taunton State Hospital, which is an allegedly haunted mental hospital. And, you know, there are allegedly haunted mental hospitals all across the country, and this one, a large portion of it no longer exists, and getting on the grounds is difficult, and getting eyewitnesses to talk about the things there is difficult. So there were some things that were just kind of tough nuts to crack that we weren't able to feature.
Gotcha.
Aaron?
I'm sorry, yeah?
No, go ahead.
I just very quickly, you had asked about, there were three things in the film that really kind of made me take a step back, and before we get too far away from that, the third was while we were shooting an interview out in the Freetown State Forest with Christopher Balzano, he was talking about this wampum belt that was presented to the colonists by the Wampanoag at the surrender of the Wampanoag people at the end of King Philip's War, and the belt has disappeared from history. And a lot of researchers theorize that the negative energy in the Bridgewater Triangle and these strange occurrences will continue until the belt is returned to the Wampanoag people. And while he was talking about this on location out in the Freetown State Forest, the lights shut off during the interview. I mean, this interview was kind of a spur-of-the-moment thing that wasn't really supposed to happen, so we kind of had to use the resources that we had to make it happen in the middle of the woods at night, and that included using this battery-operated camera light. And we had put brand new batteries in the light before shooting the interview. And while he was talking about this belt, the light shut off, which was strange. But then when we got everything back up and running, Chris kind of jokingly turned as if he was like taunting the spirits and said, "We hear your message. If I could, I would return it," in referencing the belt. And as soon as he said that, the light shut off again. And we were out in the middle of the Freetown State Forest, which has a long reputation as being a very strange place. And this light shutting off a second time happened right as he was talking about this belt and taunting these ghosts. And that was like one of those instances where I was like, wow, what are the odds of that happening? And it just really, it's one of the more popular spots in the film, too.
Was that sort of the first quote-unquote paranormal experience that you ever sort of witnessed, eyewitnessed?
Yeah, I guess in my lifetime, that is probably the strangest thing that's happened to me that could be considered paranormal. I have had no paranormal experiences prior, and I had no prior experiences after.
Well, you know what? You're mentioning, you know, the wampum belt. That leads me to my next question, and I can't help but ask this question because I'm Native American. I come from Cherokee ancestries. One of the theories for the paranormal phenomena goes back to the King Philip's War and the curse that Chief Anawan placed on the land because of the cruel deaths that occurred to his people. Do you put any money behind this theory, or do you think this might have something to do with the satanic cults that once used the land for rituals and sacrifices?
It's interesting because if you watch the film, we have a gentleman named Tim Weisberg that's featured quite extensively in the film, and he feels that perhaps there was something in the land that was even the spark of King Philip's War. So in other words, he thinks that maybe the whatever energies are driving the phenomenon in the Bridgewater Triangle may have predated that conflict and may have actually been the cause of that conflict rather than the conflict being the cause of the triangle. So then again, you have that chicken or the egg thing. But in terms of the cult tie-in, the Freetown State Force is the part of the triangle that bore witness to a lot of that satanic activity. And one of the misnomers of that, one of the misconceptions I should say about that is a lot of people say, oh, these satanic murders happened in the Freetown State Forest, when in reality, there's never been a human victim of satanic ritual sacrifice ever found within the boundaries of either the Freetown State Forest or the entire Bridgewater Triangle. The murders of those three prostitutes that we talk about in the film actually occurred in towns outside of the boundaries of the Bridgewater Triangle. Now, whether the supernatural adheres to hard boundaries and won't cross the line is a topic of a whole other discussion. But, you know, to say that the satanic activity in the Freetown State Forest would be the cause of the odd occurrences in the Bridgewater Triangle is tough to say. I mean, the Bridgewater Triangle and strange reports from areas like the Hockomock Swamp even predated any record of any of that activity ever being discovered in the Freetown State Forest, which is actually 20 miles to the southeast of the Hockomock Swamp. So they're two separate locations. So odd occurrences were being reported in the area long before any evidence of that was being found in the forest.
Okay. Well, you know what? It does make me think, you know, to your knowledge, when you were researching, as far as the Native American aspect going and the land, did you come across anyone, any Native American that tried to reverse the curse that King Philip supposedly caused, or did you get a Native American perspective as to what's going on?
No, unfortunately, the Native Americans in this area are pretty tight-lipped when it comes to that kind of a thing, and I don't blame them for that. What happened in this region basically set the precedent for the mistreatment of the Native Americans for the next 200 years and further. So they weren't so willing to participate in something like this, and it's hard to get any of them to speak on record about the paranormal in general, at least from our perspective. And the whole concept of a possible curse as the cause of the Bridgewater Triangle is I think more or less a theory brought on by enthusiasts and researchers and not necessarily something from the Native Americans themselves. It's kind of King Philip's Soul occurred over 300 years ago, so it would be difficult to know if there was ever a curse placed on the region. The Native Americans at that time, you know, were still passing down their traditions orally, so there would be no written record like saying, you know, King Philip, before he died, placed a curse. You know, it would just be theory. And I from my perspective, being a skeptic, I don't really believe in curses, so it's difficult for me to cite that as the reason for these strange occurrences. We present it in the film because it is a popular theory, but you know, we weren't trying to steer it in that direction. We just presented the information as we received it. I didn't really answer your question. It's kind of a tough one to answer.
Okay.
No, sure. It's a difficult area to research, as you were just saying, because most of the quote-unquote documented history of Native American culture and stories are oral. So there's no real facts that you can just look up, unless you interview and research within the ancestry of the tribe, and if there are any still around and living, you may be able to get something from them, but I'm not. Did you go that route? Did you try and search out to see if there's any ancestry that are still living on the land?
Well, there is a Native American presence in the region, but it seems like the further east you go in the United States, people that are of Native American ancestry, the percentage that they are of Native American ancestry gets smaller and smaller, and it makes sense because the further east you go, the longer ago it was that those people were eradicated from the region. So you're talking about people that were basically wiped out over 300 years ago, and anybody that's around that may have had a relative that was of Wampanoag ancestry, you know, a lot of the people around here, they might be 1/16 Wampanoag or 1 1/20th Wampanoag ancestry. So it's unfortunately, a lot of the people that are of Native American ancestry in this region may not even necessarily know a lot about the history because it happened so long ago, and there's no record of it other than what was written by the English, which, you can't trust that.
Right.
So it's kind of a tricky thing. And, I looking back on this film, I wish we could have gotten more participation from the Native Americans. Maybe if we had done a better job to assure them that we were approaching the subject matter from a journalistic standpoint, and we weren't, trying to spookify it or sensationalize
sure.
it in any way, maybe it would have been easier to get them on board. But no matter how you look at it, there seems to be that Native American tie-in with the Bridgewater Triangle.
Right. Well, out of all the phenomena that's been documented and recorded, has there ever been a tracking report, for lack of a better word, a tracking report done on which of the phenomenon is more prevalent? And what I mean is there more UFO accounts than Bigfoot or ghostly sightings, or are there more ghostly sightings than cryptid reports?
It's a good question, and the best way that I can answer it is it's not by quantity of a particular report. These things in the Bridgewater Triangle seem to happen by region. I think one of the misconceptions, before I get into that, one of the misconceptions about the region is for people from outside the region is that the Bridgewater Triangle is the Hockomock Swamp, and the entire swamp is the Bridgewater Triangle. And if you watch the film, we try to do our best to illustrate the fact that this is a 200-square-mile region. It's a region made up of a bunch of other locations within that region. And because of that, you have sections of the triangle that are known more for some things than other things. For example, the Hockomock Swamp, which is probably the most well-known location in the Bridgewater Triangle, is a swamp in the Bridgewater region. It kind of goes into multiple towns in that area. But that particular location is more known for cryptozoological sightings more so than anything else. I mean, you do get some reports of spook lights and ghost sightings and things of that nature. But predominantly, when you hear stories out of the Hockomock Swamp, it's usually of a sighting of like a Bigfoot creature or a thunderbird or a giant snake or something like that. Whereas when you go to like the second most famous location, which is in the Freetown State Forest in the lower right-hand portion of the triangle, that's where you get your elevated level of reports of criminal activity. And then you had the satanic cult activity that was going on down there. And you have some Native American folklore going down there because the Freetown State Forest is a Wampanoag Indian reservation. So you have those reports that come out of that region. But largely it's usually criminal type stuff that comes out of there. And then you go over to a town like Rehoboth, which is the lower left-hand corner, and that's pretty much all ghost stories and hauntings and cemeteries and things like that, and the redheaded hitchhiker of Route 44, which is more or less, I think, an urban legend, but it still comes out of the Rehoboth area and it involves a ghost. And then the town of East Bridgewater, which is to the east of the Hockomock Swamp, is another town with ghost sightings. So it's not really, it's more UFOs than Bigfoots, it's more this or that. It's whatever region, the different regions seem to be hotbeds for different things.
Mm. Okay.
I don't know if that makes any sense. Kind of a long-winded answer.
No, it makes perfect sense.
But as far as UFOs go, that's the one phenomenon which seems to occur throughout the Bridgewater Triangle and doesn't necessarily pigeonhole itself into one location.
Hmm.
Well, I found it interesting, you mentioned, the Native Americans in the area. They're kind of closed-mouthed about it, which I kind of find surprising because a lot of the activity that's happening in the area kind of does have a tie to Native American legend and folklore. But
absolutely.
I one thing that I did think about, too, what do the other locals think about this whole thing? I mean, there has to be tons of paranormal groups that go into the land to investigate. I mean, do the locals feel like they're in a zoo, or do they accept the label of the Bridgewater Triangle?
I think if you lined up 20 people on the sidewalk and asked them, 20 people in this area on the sidewalk and asked them, how many of you have heard of the Bridgewater Triangle, I would say at least half of them have. And of that half, you probably would get another half of that are firm believers that they are living in a region with an elevated level of activity, and the other half would say, I don't lend any credibility to it. But the people that do live in this region, that do embrace the concept of the Bridgewater Triangle and do believe in its existence, I think they've just come to accept it, and they have managed to live their everyday lives. I mean, we're not talking about an area like the Bennington Triangle that's, you know, remote woodlands. I mean, we do have the Freetown State Forest and the Hockomock Swamp, which are large tracts of uninhabited land, but the rest of the Bridgewater Triangle is a pretty densely populated area. I mean, you got some major cities either within the triangle or just outside the triangle. You got major highways running through there. So people that live in the area have no choice but to just, you know, live their lives as they do. And but on the same side of that, you do have a lot of paranormal groups in the area. I mean, you have a lot of paranormal groups in Massachusetts anyway, it seems. I mean, it's one of the oldest states in the union. You have the whole Salem witch trial tie-in. You have the Lizzie Borden case. You have all of that stuff kind of in a melting pot of the paranormal in Massachusetts. So you have a lot of groups that come out to these different locations and investigate. And I always chuckle when people from the outside say, I want to go investigate the Bridgewater Triangle. It's pretty much impossible to investigate the Bridgewater Triangle. You have to choose one of the locations within the triangle to investigate. And then when you can check them all off your list, then you can say, I've investigated the Bridgewater Triangle.
Right.
Well, that was my thought when I was watching. It was like, I want to go here. But you know what? This film was released about 4 or 5 months ago. So what has been the reaction from the critics and the locals? I mean, have you gotten any feedback, any pushback? What's it been like?
It has been overwhelmingly positive, the feedback that we've gotten. I mean, when we were doing this, we knew there was going to be an interest because there's just an interest in the paranormal. The Bridgewater Triangle is a topic that's known not just locally. I mean, we're talking about a topic that's known internationally, especially amongst the paranormal community. I mean, there was a podcast show in Australia back when we were about to release the film that was talking about our film and talking about the Bridgewater Triangle. So we knew there was going to be an interest in it. We weren't really prepared for the reaction that we got. I mean, we premiered this film at the University of Massachusetts Dartmouth on October 20th, and we sold out to a crowd of 750 people.
Wow.
And we showed the film a week later at Bridgewater State University, and we sold out that auditorium to 450 people. And the thing that was most impressive about that is the way that they handled their ticket sales, you just called in, said how many tickets you wanted, and then you paid for them at the door when you got there. But what happened was the Red Sox made it to the World Series, and up in Massachusetts, we take our baseball very seriously. So I love the Red Sox, but at the same time, I was like, oh, crap, nobody's going to show up for this screening tonight. You know, nobody paid in advance for their tickets. They're all picking them up at the door. But we sold out and filled the place, 450 people, and we're turning people away at the door while going head-to-head with the Red Sox in the World Series. And that was probably the most humbling night that I've experienced so far with the film. It's just I could not believe that many people would have showed up that night. And we've had probably close to at least 20 showings, if not more, since the premiere, and we've sold out probably at least 70 to 80% of them.
So your interest is coming from outside Massachusetts too, right?
Yeah, we're starting. You know, we get requests on our Facebook and website regularly from people that aren't from Massachusetts that want to see the film. And now we do have the on-demand option on the website that people can access to see the film. But prior to that, you know, people were like, "Well, I don't live in the area. I can't make it to any of these screenings or any of these venues. But I want to see the film. When's the DVD coming out?" You know, we're planning to release the DVD in this coming summer. But people, you know, people are impatient. It's an instant gratification society that we live in, especially with all this electronic media. And so people wanted to see it. So we had to put it out there on demand to kind of meet the demand that we were getting. And but like I said, the response has been overwhelmingly positive. We're getting almost universally positive feedback. We've had some official reviews written for the film, all of which have been positive, and we just can't thank the people enough that have come out to support this kind of a independent grassroots project.
Well, you know, I can vouch. Lucy and I both have seen this film, and, you know, not just the content of the film itself and the stories and the history that you present in there, it, even to down to the way it's been edited and the way that it's sort of been packaged and, you know, a nice little bow put on the top of it, it's a really well-made film. And it's very rare to find a film like this, first of all, on the paranormal itself, because a lot of them are sort of smaller independent folks that are putting this together. This to me, this, first of all, it's an intriguing topic to talk about, and there's not a lot of documentaries or films, I don't think, on the Bridgewater Triangle. So to have a sort of rare topic, a rare discussion topic, and a rare film on something, or a film that's on something that's pretty rare, and to have it well made and well produced, you know, just kudos to you guys on that. But
we thank you very much for that. It's a really nice compliment. And I think when we were, you know, I should say I have the advantage of, you know, I do video production for a living. You know, I can't say I do documentary films for a living yet. You know, I'd like my career to eventually take me in that direction, but, you know, I do, you know, television commercials and corporate videos and all that kind of stuff to pay the bills. So I have all of the tools necessary to put something like this together. So we were fortunate enough to be in that position where we really did not need to outsource anything for this film other than some hand-drawn illustrations, the off-screen narrator, and the music, because we're not composers, so we had to buy the stock royalty-free music. But other than that, we did absolutely everything in-house. And we did not rely on outside funding. We funded this out of pocket. But I think when you tell people, you know, we're doing a documentary about the Bridgewater Triangle, we're doing a documentary about the paranormal, I think people get a preconceived notion in their minds about what it's going to be. I think a lot of people go into it assuming that it's going to be a bunch of kids running around in the woods with a camera, like the Blair Witch Project or something like
right.
that, or, you know, one of these ghost hunting shows. And
right.
I don't think people were prepared for what, not that they weren't prepared, but I don't think people were expecting what they got with our film, which was more of a historical look at this region. And we tried to do it in a way that is unique to the genre. I really can't say I've ever seen a film in the paranormal genre that's like what we've put together.
And that's exactly what I was trying to say before. Maybe I didn't say the right words, but that's exactly what I was trying to convey to everybody, that it's not what you typically think of as a paranormal documentary. I mean, you could see this on the History Channel. I can see this being on National Geographic. That, you know, that's just how great that this film was produced. But now that after, you know, after you filmed it and it's sort of out in the public and you've had some time to sort of, you know, bask in the glow of everything that's going on, have you kept up with some of the more recent cases or people sort of reaching out to you about the stories that they've had? Have there been more current sightings of phenomena that you can share, or has anything new that has been discovered since you've sort of stopped filming?
Yeah, it's something that we knew was going to happen, and it was unfortunate, because you gotta know, it's like an artist doing a painting. You gotta know when to stop adding brush strokes. And we knew that as soon as we said, all right, we're done, here's a picture wrapped movie, that people were going to come out of the woodwork with stories. I think when people see other people telling stories about this region, it makes them more comfortable and more likely to share their stories. And sure enough, like within days of releasing, the day that we released the film, we'd have people come up to us and say, I saw, you won't believe it, but I saw this creature in this part of the Hockomock Swamp, or I saw a ghost in this town, or I saw a UFO over the skies of this town. And there's just been countless stories that have come out since the film has been released. And one of the things that we ended up doing was accepting people's story submissions for our website. So there's a section on the website that's called Your Stories, and we list them chronologically. People submit them in email. They can submit them anonymously, or they can attach their names to it, whatever they choose to do. And we just put the stories up verbatim. And now there's a whole list of sightings that have occurred as recently as a year ago or closer. And even right after we released the film, there was a Bridgewater State College student who filmed some bizarre lights in the sky outside of his dorm room window, posted the clip to YouTube, and within 2 days he had over 30,000, actually I think it may have been 70,000 views within 48 hours of his alleged UFO footage. Now, you know, experts have gone on to analyze that footage, and you have a lot of people that say it was nothing more than Chinese lanterns in the sky. But it just goes to show that that these stories are still coming out of the Bridgewater Triangle, and people are still documenting this, their odd occurrences there, and that it does have a following. I mean, 70,000 views in 2 days. I mean, our teaser trailer has been up on YouTube for well over a year, and it only has 15,000, and this guy got 70,000 in 2 days just because he pointed a camera at the sky and claims he saw a UFO. So, you know, we were lucky enough to meet that guy. He's a very nice gentleman, and he actually attended one of our shows.
Well, there's a person in chat, Trina Martin, and she has a question. How do you know when some people are making up their stories? Did you sort of have help in trying to decipher when you were filming the documentary to decipher whether or not they were true? I mean, I'm sure you had to do a lot of back research once you interviewed someone, but did you sort of work on instinct as far as is it believable or not?
Exactly. That's the only thing you can go on with something like that. But there were a couple instances where people came to us, and this is the thing that sets off alarm bells for me, is when somebody comes to us and says, you know, I have had a lot of experiences in the Bridgewater Triangle. You know, in 1970, I saw a UFO. In 1975, I saw a Bigfoot. In 1980, I saw a ghost. And then I saw the red-headed hitchhiker, and I saw this, and I saw that. When you've got one person that's claiming to have seen every single phenomenon that's occurred within the Bridgewater Triangle, it kind of makes me say, thanks, but no thanks. We'll pass on that. I find the more interesting and the more credible witnesses are the ones that, like Bill Russo, who saw what he saw, sat on the story for 20 years, and still at that point had never even heard of the Bridgewater Triangle. I think those are the most interesting people to talk to, and those come across as the most credible witnesses. And actually, some of the people that claim that they've seen things but then don't grant interviews or don't want the publicity, those people are really interesting. There was a retired police officer who claims that he saw a Thunderbird in Mansfield, which is a town just west of the Hockomock Swamp and the Bridgewater Triangle. And to this day, he stands by what he saw, but he does not talk about it. He will not grant interviews. He turns down people left and right who want to talk to him about what he saw, and it makes his story that much more intriguing.
Well, you briefly mentioned, you know, like some of the murders that occurred, they occurred outside the boundaries. But have you noticed that the boundaries of the triangle are expanding and growing? I mean, have there been sightings or activity outside, and has it been documented?
Yeah, it's, you know, Chris, the last portion of the film is we kind of leave that as a way for these experts that have researched this so much to lend their opinions as to what's going on here. And the borders of the triangle are discussed. And a lot of these people say, well, these borders need to be expanded or these borders need to be altered. And you do have some areas within the Bridgewater Triangle, these towns that don't necessarily have much of a history of any odd occurrences or sightings. But then you have towns like Fall River, which are technically just outside of the southern edge of the Bridgewater Triangle. And Fall River has a huge history of strange occurrences or murders and unsettling stories. It's one of these old depressed mill towns. Of course, you got the Lizzie Borden case, and then you have that whole case involving that ring of prostitutes and pimps in 1978 that were also allegedly participating in these satanic rituals, and they were conducting their rituals both in the Freetown State Forest, which is within a short drive of the city of Fall River, and in a Fall River housing project. So there are areas that, you know, a lot of people say, well, that should be included or that should be excluded. And just like I said earlier, would the paranormal or would the supernatural really adhere to a man-made boundary line that was defined, or is it not really a triangle at all? Is it, you know, the southeastern Massachusetts blob, you know, or is it just this area in particular and it's not necessarily a triangle? It's all up for debate.
Well,
what
do you hope to accomplish with this film? I mean, what do you wish your viewers to take away from the documentary?
I think that the film has something to offer for everybody. If you're into the paranormal, there's plenty of that. If you're into true crime, there's some of that. If you're not into other aspects of the paranormal, but you're into UFOs, there's that. And I if you're a skeptic, like I said, it's an interesting film to watch just based on the whole cultural phenomenon of the Bridgewater Triangle, and it's entertaining to see how many people are coming out with stories. So I like my career to head in the direction of being able to do documentary films on a full-time basis and not have to do, you know, TV commercials anymore. And I hope that people may say, wow, you know, that was a well-done documentary. You know, maybe we'd like to work with these guys on something else. So that's what I hope people take away from it. I just want it to be known as a well-produced, low-budget film that kind of changed the way that paranormal documentary films are made or thought of.
Well, you know, obviously the entire stories behind the Bridgewater Triangle can't be crammed into a 90-minute film. So are there plans for a part two or, dare I say, part three?
You know, we get asked that a lot, and I don't know. We get a lot of people saying you have to do a sequel now with all these other stories that you're getting. And there are other topics, you know, like I said, that we weren't able to cover this first time around, but maybe because we have this under our belt, you know, we'd be more apt to get more people to talk to us about things. You know, we're kind of more on the radar now in the paranormal community with this. So, you know, it's possible. A sequel is possible. You know, there's been people saying, oh, this should be, you know, you should do a multi-episode TV series where teams go out and investigate these different locations in the Triangle, which would be fun. I do enjoy the paranormal as a genre, even though I'm not a researcher or an investigator, but there are other topics that I'd like to pursue as a filmmaker. And, you know, one of them is another case that actually, you know, some people even try to tie in with the Bridgewater Triangle. I'd love to do a documentary on a series of events that occurred in the late 80s called the New Bedford Highway Murders. And there were 11 prostitutes that wound up dead on the highways between New Bedford and Fall River, which are really close by here in southeastern Massachusetts. And it's actually the deadliest serial killer in New England history, and the case went unsolved. And it actually was, the case was opened back up by the district attorney a couple years ago. And I think that would be a fascinating topic for a documentary. And that's one of those cases like the Lizzie Borden slayings and the cult murders in Fall River that gets tied into this whole concept of the Bridgewater Triangle, even though New Bedford is technically outside the border. So that's another example of a town that people would like to see tied into the Bridgewater Triangle.
Hmm. That sounds really interesting. And I do see the link. I do see that tie-in. And, would you continue doing paranormal documentaries, or are you afraid of being sort of typecasted with that genre?
I don't want to get pigeonholed into paranormal. I don't want to be known as the guy who does paranormal documentaries. I would like to be known as a guy who could do a good paranormal documentary,
right?
But not necessarily a paranormal documentary filmmaker. But I mean, just in general, I'm. For whatever reason, my taste in films, most of the movies that I like are not necessarily happy movies. They're usually kind of a dark tone movies. And, you know, a classic example is my favorite movie of all time is The Empire Strikes Back. And if you look at the Star Wars franchise, that is definitely the darkest, moodiest, most unhappy film in the series. But in my opinion, it's the best. Even if it's not necessarily a paranormal documentary, you know, it's pretty much a guarantee that whatever documentaries I'm doing or working on are probably not going to be happy subjects.
Oh, it's going to be mysterious. It's going to be intriguing. I think that's what viewers want, you know?
Yeah, it is. I think, you know, there's something more interesting about the dark and mysterious than, you know, a documentary about, you know, sunshines and rainbows.
Well, yeah, I mean, and it's more intriguing for the viewers to be able to sit there and watch something and try and deduce what the possibilities could be in their own mind, you know, sort of playing the investigator for themselves. I mean, that's what you do with this documentary, which is so great. And if you can continue that with others, I think you've got a hook on it, because that's what viewers love to do. They love to try and put their own two cents into it, or try and put their own judgment into the mix and try and figure it out themselves.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. And, the film, unfortunately, you know, if people are going into it looking for hard answers, you know, it doesn't really offer that. It just offers theories and leaves things open to debate.
you know what, Aaron? I mean, the film, you hit a home run with me. I mean, as far as paranormal goes. And it's absolutely amazing. How can our listeners learn more about your research and see the film?
You can go to our website, thebridgewatertriangledocumentary.com. You can also go to bridgewatertriangle.com. It leads to the same place. We own both of those domains. And right on the front page, there's a link to watch the movie on demand. Lucky for us, Vimeo, which is probably the second most well-known video website after YouTube, it's more of a professionally based video service, came out with an on-demand option. So for $5.99, you can get a 24-hour rental of the documentary through Vimeo. The link is right up on our website. You just simply sign up for a free Vimeo account, punch in your credit card information, and then you have 24 hours to watch the film. And that's been a popular option for people. If you live close by in the New England region and are listening right now, you can also go to our website and click on upcoming shows to see the film in person in a theatrical venue. We have a bunch of shows coming up. We have and one in particular, we have a show in at the Dedham Community Theater on Sunday, April 6th. And Jeff Belanger, who is a well-known paranormal researcher and author and writer for the Ghost Adventures show, who participated in our film, will be in attendance and be available for question and answer, and people can meet him and things like that. So that's one of the screenings that we have coming up. So there are a number of different ways to see the film now, and we are hoping to release the DVD and Blu-ray this summer, and, of course, we'll make that available for purchase. And we do have, I can't say too much about it, but we do have a very high-profile cable network that contacted us regarding the U.S. broadcast rights to the film. So it could very well find its way to a national audience sooner rather than later.
Wow, that's great.
Something that we're very excited about.
Excellent.
Yeah, and it was flattering because they came to us. We didn't, we didn't solicit them. We didn't send them anything. They kind of emailed us out of the blue, which was very flattering and very exciting.
Well, they see talent, so,
thank you.
That's cool. That's so cool. Well, you know what, Aaron? We can't thank you enough for coming on the show. You know, this story is just so weird and so exciting that I had to watch the film a couple of times. So, everyone, please go and check out BridgewaterTriangleDocumentary.com, and we'll certainly post the link on our Facebook page. I really enjoyed the film, and it was really fun to talk to you. Thank you again.
Thank you both so much. I have a tendency to ramble with some things, and I appreciate you bearing with me on that. And it was an honor to be on with you guys. And I'll definitely recommend your show to anybody that will listen. You guys do a great job.
Great.
Thank you.
You were a perfect guest, Aaron. Thank you so much for coming on.
Oh, thank you for having me, and have a great night and have a great weekend.
You too. Have a great weekend.
Thanks, Aaron.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. So, I've watched this film, I'd have to say, maybe four times. How many times did you watch it, Lucy?
I watched it three times.
How many?
Three.
Not only just because I didn't catch anything the first time, there were a couple of different parts within the film that intrigued me, and I mentioned it earlier. The one was the eyewitness of William Russo, his account of this creature that he sort of came in contact with as he was walking his dog in his neighborhood. First of all, it was such a different story than I've ever heard anyone sort of recount before. We've all heard the Bigfoot stories of some sort of elusive, hairy creature running in the woods and sort of in the distance and it passing by, and maybe even seen a possible snapshot or two of a possible case of it. Or you've seen and heard the accounts of, alien encounters and people who say that they've got little gray men in their bedroom and sort of staring at them and then all of a sudden disappearing. Bill Russo's story in this film, I'm telling you, and I'm not joking, I'm not kidding, I got chills. I don't know about you, Lucy, but I got chills when I was listening to him talk about it. And there's actual a drawing of this creature that he encountered. But what fascinated me about about his story was the communication. And Bill Russo so brilliantly tried to reenact or I guess regurgitate what that creature was trying to say to him. And I'm not going to say what it is because you have to watch the film. And he repeated it over and over again. And as he was repeating it, it was sort of garbled, jarbled. I don't know. It's not like a language, but it's sort of like English, but sort of a broken English type of translation to what this creature was saying to him. And before he thought he was telling and revealed what he thought this creature was saying, I was thinking the same thing. And I don't know. Whenever I hear stories like that, I put myself in their shoes, and I try and think, what the hell would I do at that moment? You know, if I'm standing there with my dog at night, and there's a sort of light post at the side of the street there, shining down, and I see this thing that's got short hair all over him, and saying what he was saying to me, I don't know what the hell I would do. I mean, yeah, you know, we've talked about not being scared and not being afraid. Obviously, we are a little afraid when we do paranormal investigating, but I don't know what the hell I would do. I mean, you've seen that story, you've heard him, Bill Russo, talk about it, Lucy. What would you, I don't know, what did you think, and what would you have done?
Well, the first thing is that just watching him, watching his body language, watching the way he just told the story. He is a very believable person.
Yeah.
And when I heard what he was saying, it's very obvious that whatever was communicating with him doesn't speak our language normally. I mean, you could tell just by the way that he's saying what this thing was saying, you could hear that it's like trying to communicate, trying to get a grasp on the language in order to get that across. Now, what would I do if I saw something like that? Part of me would want to stand there, whip out a camera, and try to document what I'm seeing because I know no one would believe me. And then
right.
The other part would be like, okay, I need to be ready to run, you know. I mean, there was a couple things that were mentioned in this film. And one thing that we didn't mention, there's a clip of a woman who is, the only way you can describe it is that she's possessed by something.
Oh, yes, yeah. And that's actual footage.
Yeah, yeah. The thing that really got me about it, it's kind of grainy and it's kind of dark. But you see enough of it. It was the sounds that were coming out of this woman gave
right.
me chills. That made my hair stand up because you really have to see this. I mean, it's actual footage. You see this woman, and then all of a sudden, it's just like wham! It's like a door opens up, and the sounds that were coming out of her. Because at first, the first time I saw it, it was kind of hard to tell. But after I watched it a couple times, and I kept rewinding it over and over to see this, the sounds are unbelievable. No one can fake that kind of sound. That was something that was coming deep from within her, and that wasn't her. That definitely wasn't her. I was convinced that this was something that was real.
And I think if I remember correctly, there were two men that were trying to, I think, hold her down.
They were trying to subdue her.
Yeah, they were trying to calm her down at that point. And that's actual footage that Aaron had put into this documentary, which I thought was amazing. You know, we talked about it before with Aaron that, you know, when people talk about paranormal documentaries, I've seen tons. I can't even tell you how many documentaries, I'm sure Lucy can say the same thing too, that we've watched, you know, either on YouTube or we've had access to from groups or from folks who have produced things. And I'm really not, and I'm going to get real right now, I'm really not shitting you all out there. I mean, I'm not bullshitting you. I'm not, believe me, Aaron's not giving me any money for this film. I'm not here to endorse anything. Nobody's paying me to do anything. This film is completely different than what your mindset thinks of when you think of a supernatural or paranormal documentary on a subject, on a topic, especially a location like the Bridgewater Triangle. This truly is not what you're thinking if you have not seen this film. It is not what you are used to seeing online or anywhere else. It is, as Aaron was saying, it's a low-budget film, but it is so superbly made. It is so amazingly edited. Like I said before, it's almost as if you would actually see this on National Geographic or the History Channel. I don't even think, say History Channel called up Aaron Amara. I don't even think the History Channel would tweak it to amp it up or exaggerate it a bit so that it is sort of worthy of public television or cable television, because I think you can be slipped right into any time slot right now on primetime television on one of these channels and just played. That's it. It really is. And, the interviewees that are in the documentary, we talked about Jeff Belanger being in there and Lauren Coleman, who is the foremost cryptozoologist, and Lauren is the one who actually dubbed the name the Bridgewater Triangle. I think it was back in the late 70s when he was researching it. He was the one that created that name for it, and hence has sort of melted over all these years and has become his title for it. So he's got really great people in this film, really great stories. It is edited really well. Music is great. The transitions, even from when he's talking and they're talking about the history of Native Americans and plopping in the parts of real, I'm trying to think of the word, real videos, as what Lucy was just talking about in that sort of quote-unquote possession-like piece from an eyewitness. And just the transition back and forth. I watched it the first time I clicked on it and watched it. I watched it from beginning to end, no interruption at all. And then after it ended, I then went back and played it again. And then, and that was in the very beginning when we first known that we were going to have a show like this on. And then just, I think it was last weekend, I watched it two more times just as I was doing research, to figure out questions and such. And then Sunday night, Monday night, there was nothing on television. So I said, you know what, I'm going to watch it again. And so I watched the film again. That's just how great it is. I won't get bored of it. And I think each time I watched it those times, I found something that I didn't catch all the other times. So it's a really great film. The Bridgewater Triangle documentary.com. I mean, go to it, $5.99. It's half of a pack of a cigarette. Yeah, half a pack of cigarettes, or, it's what, 4 Diet Cokes, Lucy?
Well, you know what? I'm not going to lie. I mean, my interest in this really did stem from the Native American connection. And
right. You
get the history and you get that in there. But as you're watching this documentary, to agree with you, I agree with you 100%. This is not what you think it's going to be. Once you start watching it, there is just so much that's happening in this area. And I think these guys did such an amazing job of bringing it, kind of like summarizing it all together. You go from one to the other to the other. So by the time you're done with this film, you're like, whoa, I didn't really know that much about the area before we did this, before we started doing the research. I mean, I had heard of it. I'd heard of, some of the occurrences that happened there. But I never really knew anything about the history, never knew really how intense what was happening there. After seeing this film, I want to go there. I mean, I'm one of those people that watching it, I want to go. And my whole idea about going there is I really want to see, with all the occurrences that happened to the Native Americans there, that's my draw to this place. I mean, the swamp and all of the atrocities that happened on both sides, both to the settlers and to the Native American. I mean, this is a pretty violent and sad place. And taking into account what we always say about the history, the land. Okay, the name Hockomock means place where spirits dwell. So obviously the Native Americans probably already had an idea that something happens in this area.
Mm.
But adding to the mix everything else that happened, you've got the settlers coming in, you've got the Native Americans, you know, everything that happened between them. That's adding to what's already there. I still can't help but feel that the land has got to have a certain vibe. I want to feel that. I want to see what's going on there. And then add in, now you've got a Bigfoot sighting. You've got Pukwudgies. You've got UFOs. I mean, how is it that certain places like this place, and like you mentioned in your intro, you know, Skinwalker Ranch and some of these other places, why is it that there are certain places that just seem to be a magnet for everything that occurs there? These are kinds of things that I want to go. So I think we need to take a month and just go and explore this whole area.
Well, just backpack and trek across the Bermuda Triangle, the Bridgewater Triangle.
Now, see, and knowing me, I'll probably get lost in the swamp.
Yeah, because you don't wear shoes. That's why.
No, of course not.
You know, one of the things that interested me, because, you know, knowing you for all these years, and as we investigate, you know, we always joke and talk about how, you know, most of the hauntings that we've come in contact with or encountered as we investigate, and the locations that we research and go into, have some sort of Native American past or, you know, Native American history to it that could tie into whatever that supernatural experience that someone is experiencing. It could be the possible cause of, or the reason why, or could possibly be the attraction to the energy that is left behind by Native Americans. You know, it could be a whole bunch of things, or it could be things that I don't even know about yet that I can't even understand at this point. But one of the things that intrigued me about this was trying to see and find out, and, you know, this intrigues me. His film, this film that Aaron and Manny put together, The Bridgewater Triangle, has intrigued me enough that I want to do some research and find out if, you know, Native American or not, if there were any groups or individuals out there that wanted to or have tried to put an end to the curse, have tried to, you know, make amends or appease the Native American spirits that may still roam the land or, you know, rule the land in such a negative manner because of the atrocities that happened during the King Philip's War. I'm curious to see if there were any folks out there that have tried to and maybe done a ceremony in such a way that was in anticipation of giving maybe an offering or giving a settlement to this quote-unquote curse that's supposedly there. You know, has there been anyone that tried to do it? And if so, has it helped? Has it done anything? Have they received any communication back as far as will they give it up or will they sort of reverse the curse? I don't know. That intrigues me to find that out if anything like that has ever been done.
Well, see, I didn't know that there's an Indian reservation near there. That's where I think I'd like to start. I'd like to see what the natives think of this whole thing, what they've learned about it, what, like you said, has anyone tried to go in, tried to appease, you know, the spirits? I think it's interesting, like in the film clip that he mentioned, you know, when he said, when the interview, the guy said, you know, well, if I had the belt, I'd return it. And then all of a sudden the lights go out. I mean, that right there shows me that, yeah, someone's there, something's listening. There has to be some kind of connection. Sure, you know, maybe the batteries, it's coincidence. Maybe something's happened. But until I see and feel, that's what I'm really interested in. I want to see what natives in the area feel, what they are, what's going on. I mean, and then the other part about it is, I mean, you know, it couldn't all just be Native American. We're talking about the satanic cults. How is it that, you know, you've got these murders going on, you've got all these things, could these people who are doing this dark stuff open up doorways that are bringing more negative to the area?
Yeah, or just amping up that energy, you know, creating a higher frequency as they're doing it. You know, one of the other things that also intrigues me about this area is the attraction. And, you know, the elephant in the room is basically, you know, why does this triangle exist? Why is there such a not so much defined space. I mean, it's not defined. And when you say Bridgewater Triangle, it's not like it's a boundary as far as, you know, United States and Canada. You know, there is no definitive line in that nature. Of course, it's a little blurry and it's a little hazy, and there are going to be accounts outside of what people talk about when they draw that triangle. But I think the main question of this is why is there this attraction to this area? Is it the Native American history to it? Is it because, and I think Aaron had sort of talked about this, is it sort of an aftermath of people's perception as to, okay, if atrocities happen to Native Americans, then obviously they're still upset and they could be causing trouble. And it's people's perception of, you know, oh, did I just see a Bigfoot just run by? Did I just see a ghost? Is it their interpretation based on the facts that they created in their mind of the history that is creating the visions that they're and experiences that they're seeing now? Or is it actual reality? Is it actual Bigfoot? Is it actual UFOs? Is it actual ghosts that is happening there? And if so, then what is that attraction? You know, Lucy and I have talked about this, again, many, many times on our show about this, you know, invisible thread that lies between all of the paranormal topics, between Bigfoot, UFO, ghosts, cryptids, and so on, that there is a baseline that, sort of a common denominator that I know Lucy and I are finding within our research, that they all have, and it is this energy, and it is this light that sort of connects all of them together. And so is it that it's sort of one and the same? And again, I think we mentioned this last week, that this energy is just taking different forms as a Bigfoot, as a UFO, as a ghost, just because it can change its form. And, you know, just like, you know, when you wake up in the morning, you decide what you want to wear that day. And so those are the clothes that you're going to wear. When you go to bed, you take those clothes off, you put your pajamas on, or you go to bed naked, however you want to do it. And then you wake up the next morning and you put on a different set of clothes. Is it that way with this energy? Are they just shape-shifting or transforming differently? And is it just one, or are we talking about an energy that's attracting different energies, completely different energies to this one area, as you would sort of consider to be a vortex? And it opens up so many other questions and theories that it gets my mind going, and I can talk about this for the next, you know, 4 to 5 hours. But it really is interesting, and the film Bridgewater Triangle really, again, sort of substantiates a lot of my thoughts and ideas within the paranormal, but also opens a whole slew of other questions that, I don't know, that are really interesting to me to help me research more on and expand it on.
Well, you know, one thing that comes to mind while you're talking is, we've touched on it a couple of times too, if enough people visualize something happening, do they manifest that? Are some of these experiences just a result of that mass thought process where everyone's
right,
thinking, oh, yeah, there's Bigfoot, and if enough people believe that there's Bigfoot, then all of a sudden they see it? You know, is that another case? I mean, that kind of interests me. We've touched on that a couple of times. That interests me to the fact that, okay, so we have paranormal activity that happens in different locations. how much of it really is manifestation of a single thought process coming by so many people? Can we actually manifest something into being?
I think that's a great point. I mean, are we creating that energy because of the belief in it? And if you've got countless number of people who continually to believe a legend or a story and are entering the, you know, Bridgewater Triangle, are they manifesting it themselves? Are they perceiving it that way? And, you know, sort of a natural occurrence, but are they perceiving it to be supernatural? But also, too, are we creating that energy because of the lore? The lore, it's almost like having that sort of sexual attraction to something. Is it that it's so enticing that you think it's so hard and you want it so bad that if you've got countless number of people doing that same thing or feeling that same way, we've heard stories like this before, that you actually materialize that thought and that idea and that aspect? Is it that? This topic just, you know, in the film itself just, you know, brings up so many different variations to the paranormal, to the supernatural, that it'll drive you freaking crazy, first of all, because you run in so many tangents and so many branches on this thing that so many possibilities, and yet you'll never get an answer. You will never get an answer on it. But it's always great and fun and exciting and intriguing and mysterious to sort of wonder what, why, and trying to find that elusive answer that you will probably most likely never catch.
Well, Aaron is in the chat room, and he did put some. He typed in, "Current officials are usually reluctant to talk about that," and that's one thing that I did notice. I noticed that when I went to Gettysburg, when I went to the visitor center, you know, of course, I want to know about the paranormal happening. It was very hard to find someone who was actually working in the visitor center, employed by the state or whoever runs it, to talk about it. I finally found one older guy that was very willing to tell me where, what, and how. So the fact that this location has so much going and there's so many stories that come from it leads me to believe that there is really something happening here. You're not going to get an official account of what's going on, but you're getting people that are willing to share different stories. And even if they don't know each other, there are things coming to light. So on the theory of maybe manifesting, you know, the mass manifestation, that's one thing. But in this case, too, I mean, I think the documentary points out that there are different people who don't know each other, who have different experiences, and each one of them are experiencing something. So there is just so much there that it does lead me to believe that this definitely is something happening. And we barely touched on the subject of the UFO.
I think in the towards the very beginning of our talk tonight, or maybe it was in the middle, we had asked Aaron or talked about if there was any research done in discovering if there were any similarities between the Bridgewater Triangle and others of the like the Skinwalker Ranch or the Oregon Vortex in Gold Hill, Oregon. It would be interesting to find out, you know, as we talk about why or how a certain area of land is dubbed the Bridgewater Triangles of America or even of the world. You know, what is it that possibly could, I don't, not give you the answer, but maybe lead you in a direction to hopefully get more theories on the idea of how it's created? And so what is it about the Skinwalker Ranch that that is there that could possibly be the same as within the Bridgewater Triangle? You know, aside from if there are Native American backgrounds and history to it, you know, what else is it? You know, is it, are there natural occurrences that are similar? Are there, I don't know, I'm going to go out on a limb, are there points, latitude and longitude on the Earth that could have a connection to that? The theories are endless in that manner, but it's pretty interesting to try and see if there are similarities and what they could possibly be to create, because I think that may help understand how an area like the Bridgewater Triangle is formed. I mean, I live in New York. There's no, you know, Bridgewater Triangle like in Manhattan. There's nothing like that. We've got Native American history here. I'm sure there are in Chicago as well. I don't think there's anything of the Skinwalker Ranch in your area or in your town of Chicago. So what is it? And you have Native American history in your land. So what is it about the areas? Does it supersede natural? Does it become universal? Is there some sort of quantum physics answer to that? And, we could be blowing our minds at that point if we get into that topic. But, it's interesting to really delve into it and try and find the answer. Like I said, you won't get the answer, but try and find the answer. I'm always amazed whenever I go down that road, and I love to, and Lucy hates when I do this, but I always love to branch off. I always love to go deeper than anyone else, or try and go on different areas of the topic that either people may have touched on slightly but really never delved into so much. I like to hit it because I like to exhaust every avenue, and so that I'm able to sort of push it aside and say, okay, we've tackled that. There's a dead end there. We don't need to go there. Okay, let's turn around and go this way. Otherwise, I don't know, to me, you're leaving things open where the possibilities could be endless and answers could be awaiting, or even more questions could be awaiting for you. I like to go those routes, and so I may be sort of going on a tangent here and blabbering as I'm saying it right now, but I think it's worth to do that. I think it really is something that we should all innately have, because why are we living? We're here to find answers for anything. You know, everybody says, what's the meaning of life? Well, life is asking questions. Life is living life, is going in that direction. But this film, it may sound so silly to say it, but this film gave me that spark, gave me that little hit or that kick in the butt to ask more of those questions in it and include the Bridgewater Triangle in my thoughts and theories about paranormal in general, because I never really thought about this. I was never into the Skinwalker Ranch or any of that, but I did hear about the Bridgewater Triangle. I never researched it until now, and so it really is, it's an interesting topic for me. I find it satisfying. I don't know about you guys who are listening, but I do, and I think it's worth a shot to investigate it more and include it in more of your theories as a possibility of why we see paranormal, why we see ghosts, why we see UFOs. I don't know.
Well, one thing, I love watching those wheels turn in your head. I can see them.
Can you see the smoke coming out of my ears?
But then also, too, one thing that came to mind when you're talking about ley lines, okay? There's some kind of research on it. We're talking about like the Ram Inn in England, Stonehenge. You know, do these things do they truly have some kind of energy that opens up a location to activity? Is there something to do with that? I mean, we've never really done a whole lot of research on ley lines. I mean, this may be a whole show that we need to do now to talk about why is it that certain areas in the world really do have this kind of activity. Take out the history. Let's go straight to the land. Let's go straight to what's happening there. I mean, these are things that I never thought about. And watching this film, this all seems to center around the swamp. What is it about this swamp that brings, that makes it the centerpiece of what's going on here? Is it truly something in the swamp? And, you know, there's so many things that aren't documented. There's so many things that aren't there. The rock formations that are there. There's rock formations there. There's rocks that have, like, carvings and other things.
Right.
Writing on there. I mean, what does this all mean? I mean, again, every topic we do, every show we do opens up a million other doors. And it's like, okay, you know, we start here, but now there's like five more doors that have opened, you know. So it's endless, and that's what I love about what we do, because now I've never researched this area, never really got into it, didn't know anything. But now I've got this whole new avenue that I wanna explore.
And again, I think that's why what's great about this documentary that Aaron and Manny did was that it brought it, he did truly take a journalistic neutral stance when producing and editing and creating this film. It was not one-sided. It was not, okay, let's prove that there's ghosts and UFOs and Bigfoots out there. No, that's not what he did. He proposed it, and he and Manny proposed it in a way to lay out the keys for you, and it's up to you to actually pick it up and put it in a doorway and go wherever you want to go with it. That's basically the meaning of it, and I think that's why it sort of struck a chord with me and has stuck with me, because it wasn't one-sided. And that's what Lucy and I do with this show all the time, is we lay the facts out. It's up to you guys to make the decisions. It's up to you guys to have an opinion and to believe that opinion, number one, but also, two, if we've sort of helped you boast your theory on a certain paranormal topic, then great. If we've made you turn away from it, then great. I mean, it is your prerogative. That's what this is all about, this talk and this discussion and communication that we do, is to get it out there in the open, have a stance in it. I applaud the skeptic in Aaron. I appreciate that, because, you know, it's – and to understand that even just doing this film sort of – made him a slight, I wouldn't say believer, but I'd say, you know, he's sort of questioning things, I think, now, or questioning a certain experience that may have happened. Whereas before, if he would have heard somebody talk about it, he'd probably say, that's just another story. Okay, yeah, all right, okay, let's put on a Red Sox game or something. You know, that is great, first of all, to have that person behind the camera putting this film forward. And then for a person who is as skeptical as he is to put something out on film that instilled my belief, I that's a home run in my book.
Well, the film is brilliantly made, and I really do give them credit for, no matter what you're into, no matter what you go into watching this film, whatever area that you're looking for, he really does, Aaron and Manny, they really do not put their opinion into it. I mean, it's simply a presentation of what's there. So you're going to take from it what you came for, but you're also going to get something else. I watched it for the Native American connection. But then again, when there's the section, you know, you talk about the cryptozoology part about it, and then you talk about the hauntings, and then you talk about the crime that's happening. I mean, it's put together so brilliantly that it really, truly is an enjoyable experience. And if you have not seen the film, I don't know how many times we've said this tonight, you really do need to see this film. Go into it with an open mind, and whether you believe or not, I'm sure that it will strike a chord with you in one way or another. It will open a door for you. It will bring forward some more questions. And if something can make you think and give you more questions, then I think that's brilliant, absolutely brilliant.
You know, Lucy and I are interested to find out from you guys who are listening live right now, but also are going to be listening on our archives and on our YouTube channel, this show in particular, about the Bridgewater Triangle. We're interested to find out, one, if you've watched the film, The Bridgewater Triangle, the documentary, what you thought about it. We'd love for you to come to our Facebook page, the Paranormal Review Radio. If you haven't liked the page, like us, and then you can comment. And, you know, we're going to put the link to Aaron's site, thebridgewatertriangledocumentary.com, on our Facebook page. And I did put a trailer up on our Facebook page the other day, but I'm going to put it up again. And if you've seen the movie, if you've seen the film, we'd love for you to come back to the page and comment. Tell us what you thought of it. Was there anything intriguing about it? What was your favorite part of the film itself? Was it the Native American side? Was it the Bigfoot stories or the cryptid stories? Was it the UFOs? Was it the ghostly paranormal side of things? What is it that you liked about it? We'd love to hear your feedback on it, because hopefully, you know, I can see so many tremendous things happening for Aaron in this field. And hopefully, if he's listening right now still, and I think he's still in chat, we'd love to have him on again and talk about his new film, whatever it is at that time, and sort of give him that feedback from you guys. So let us know. Come back to our Paranormal page. We'll have it up probably either tonight or tomorrow, and give us some feedback on it. You can always comment on our YouTube channel, but come back to our Facebook page, Paranormal Review Radio, and leave us a comment.
I also would be very curious to see if you've gone to the area. What kind of experience have you had? I mean, what have you seen, heard, experienced? I mean, did it convince you that there's something there? Did something happen that, you know, makes you think that there truly is some kind of activity? Or did you go there and nothing happened? That I'm curious to see. I mean, he mentions a couple groups that have gone there. I would like to see what kind of experiences people have. I mean, the film does focus on the people that live there, but what about the people that come in? You know, what are you seeing? Are you getting what you came for?
All right, so Lucy, who is our fan of the week this week?
Okay. Our Paranormal Review Radio fan of the week this week is Lorraine Ghost Lady Stevens of Darbydale, Ohio. She's the co-founder and CEO of Ghost Hunters of Ohio State. She's the owner and designer at 1885 Florist. Some of her likes, she likes The Temptations, Nazareth, Godsmack, Drowning Pool, Sons of Anarchy, The Walking Dead, Haunted Collector, and of course she likes Paranormal Review Radio. Congratulations, Lorraine. Thank you so much for being a fan, and thank you for posting on our page.
Yeah, thanks, Lorraine, and I'm blowing kisses back at you because that's what's on your picture. So if you guys want to check out her picture as the fan of the week, again, come back to our Facebook page. And don't forget, if you want to be a Paranormal Review Radio fan of the week, all you got to do is just like us on Facebook and make a comment or two, Paranormal Review Radio.
Okay. Well, you know what? As a paranormal investigator, sometimes certain locations have something that just draw you to them. This is an area that has so much going on within its boundaries. Is it a result of a Native American curse, or is it an extraterrestrial base of operations? Do the spirits of the settlers still roam the land? Only more research, investigation, and time will tell what lies behind the mystery of the Bridgewater Triangle. If you dare to enter the swamp, be prepared to explore the unknown, and be careful. We want to thank Aaron for joining us tonight and talking about this unbelievable documentary. If you have not seen it, I'm going to say it again, you really have to, okay? Well, the Bridgewater Triangle is just one of the many mysteries of our world. But did you know that there is a show that explores the mysteries, the unusual, the frightening things that occur within the paranormal and beyond? Seen every Thursday and Saturday on livesci-fi.tv. Do You Believe? With host Noreen Balovich and co-host and director Tim Wood, delves into the unknown each week. Often pushing past the boundaries of normal, this duo brings the most extreme cases of the paranormal to their viewers. They will be joining us next week to talk about their extreme shows and investigations, as well as Tim's newest purchase of the Wells Bar House in Pennsylvania, the home that's known as the Amityville House of Pennsylvania. Tim will actually be calling in from the Wells House, and we'll find out what's going on in this location that makes it so frightening. Who knows? We may experience some paranormal activity live on the show. So, a word of caution. Please listen in at your own discretion. Do you believe? Tune in next week and find out. Thank you, everyone, for spending another Friday night with us. You know, you guys are all so very special to us. Thank you, Anthony, for being the best co-host in the whole world. I am just so lucky. So, dear Paranormies, keep exploring and discovering, and have a paranormal week. Good night.
Good night, everybody.
Paranormal Review Radio.